Thank you so much, Susan. Susan Engel from the 92nd Street Y. Susan used to live in my building. Okay, great. Anyway, I cannot tell you. There are no words. I have been thinking about this ever since Susan asked me if I would do this, and I begged and begged Roberta Kaplan. This is like a dream come true for me. So I just want to get that out there. Roberta Kaplan, as you all know, these people need no introductions, but she was named one of the 100 most influential lawyers in the United States of America. She was on the Out 100 list this year. She is the 2013 Litigator of the Year by American Lawyer. And yesterday, she was named Above the Law's 2013 Lawyer of the Year, which her mother is very thrilled about and is plotting somewhere where there are a lot of Jews. Anyway, Edie Windsor, I don't really know if there's any way to introduce Edie Windsor. She was number 3 on Time Magazine's Person of the Year. But in my heart, and I think in everyone else's heart, she will always be the number 1 person of the year from now on. Ladies and gentlemen, Roberta Kaplan and Edie Windsor.
Before we begin, I think I speak for everyone here when I say thank you.
Quite welcome. Quite welcome.
I've been watching like videos, and I never cry, but I can't tell you how much your relationship makes me. It's so joyous and. It is one of the most beautiful relationships. I mean, I never met Thea, of course, but if you look at anything, there are no words to describe. The pictures, the photos, the love, it just emanates. It's amazing. So I know you grew up in Philly because you have the thickest Philly accent I've ever heard. And, you actually moved to New York to be gay.
Yes, yes, definitely.
To allow yourself to be gay. And you, you had married your brother's best friend. Right. And I think you said to him, look, this isn't working and you deserve better, which is, I mean.
It didn't say it wasn't working. I really just said, you deserve much better, honey. You deserve to be what somebody really wants out of life. And I need something else.
Ugh. And then you moved to New York, and what was it like being gay at that time, and during Stonewall in the 60s and the 70s?
Well, we hadn't had any of that yet, and what it was like is I came down, I was here at a wedding first, I hadn't moved here yet, and I got on the Fifth Avenue bus, which used to go down into Washington Square and turn around and go back up Fifth Avenue. And I got off the bus there, and I was dressed to the teeth for this wedding, and I stopped a woman who had on a trench coat and a pink button-down shirt, and I asked her if she knew where if there was a bar where women only went. Okay. Anyhow.
What year was this?
I don't even know, 1950-something.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay.
And early half of the 50s, I think. And I sat down at the bar, and I ordered a drink, and I sat there, and nobody talked to me. And I sat there for 2 hours, and nobody talked to me, and then I got up and left and went back uptown to where I was. And heartbroken, just heartbroken. I learned a better way to handle the bars later.
Apparently. that's hilarious. And then you worked at IBM, and you had this very intense, important job that most women You ran this computer that was the size of a city block, correct?
Okay, it's a mistake to think that. There were tons of women in my, where I was. We were really a bastard organization of IBM to start. They took a floor in the Time Life building. IBM still believed that the software was a one-time problem. Okay, and we were going to solve the problem, and that would be the end of programming and software. Okay, and it took a while before that changed. And we were all very close, and we were all people who wouldn't leave New York mostly. And there were almost as many women as there were men. They were all smarter than hell. Later, a lot of them worked for me and educated me all the time. But we loved each other, and we drank together, we had lunch together, we drank after work together. But I never went with them on weekends when they did wine tastings. And I never came out there. I ultimately came out to customers, because I used to meet twice a year. We met on opposite coasts, because they knew more about software than we did at that point, and were enormously helpful. In the first operating systems and the like. But we would meet the night before, and before the conference started, and I would find out whose kid was now in two-wheelers, not three-wheelers, and whose wife was doing how, and I never said a word. And finally I met Thea, and years into this and finally I said, you know, guys, I'm sitting here, the most important thing in my life has happened, and I'm not saying anything. So I told them. And the next morning, one of the guys I was particularly close to said, Edie, I couldn't help fantasizing about you with a woman. And I said, oh, honey, it's, you know, just forget it. We all stayed in touch long after we had a function, you know, in building the initial stuff. And then ultimately, one guy traveled from person to person, always taking pictures. So we were up to date. And suddenly he got mad at us, one at a time, until we had no contact. I got a call when the first Google alert about our case was on. I got a call, and I used to call him James Morrison Morrison from the children's thing. I get a message on my machine which said, my name is James Morrison Morrison, and if I have found you, please call me. Okay, and it was him. And the next day, he sent a telegram to, an email, I guess, to all his grandchildren, saying this is a very strict Catholic family, right? And just saying, this is Edie Windsor, and I want her to win this case, so I want you guys to want her to win this case. And
wow.
Later, people asked me how come I never went to the wine tastings, and I said, because I was queer.
Okay. And I hate wine. No. And how'd you meet Thea? Hmm? How'd you guys meet?
Okay, I got an IBM fellowship but when they decided they really needed more software, they also decided they had to upgrade us. So we had competitive fellowships. And I got school of my choice, degree of my choice, and full scouring. And off I went. And I lasted less than a year. I hated it. It was really a bad choice. There were not really any computing stuff at all yet. I mean, there were no computer courses. There were no books. I mean, you really had to work out what the hell you're supposed to do. And I called and said I want to come back to work, which I did. And I was living on the West Side before the West Side was this marvelous liberal, you know, thing. Because friends of mine had lived there and got a great apartment and called and said, we hear you're coming back, you know, do you want us to hold an apartment for you? And so they paid the super some money to hold the apartment.
Oh, that happens all the
time. I was living in this place where nobody ever wore jeans on the weekend. I don't think anybody ever saw a lesbian unless they went downtown. And finally I called a friend of mine, an old friend, and I said, you know, please, if you know where the lesbians go, please take me. Okay. And so I went to a restaurant on a Friday evening. It was not a gay restaurant, but it was on Friday evenings, women tended to go there. And it was run by Elaine Kaufman, So she managed it then with her boyfriend, and like all her customers in the future. Okay, it was diverse. It was okay. They were all intellectual. Okay, they were totally non-discriminatory, and we were all very comfortable there on a Friday night. And somebody brought Thea over to the table and introduced her, and that was the beginning. Wasn't really the beginning. It took us 2 years to begin to date. But we
that danced. Is so unlesbian.
But we danced but we danced together all the time.
Right.
But she was always with someone. and different people, but you know, what do you call that? You know, monogamous in a row kind of thing.
Oh yeah, serial monogamy.
Yeah. And
cats.
And I didn't do that. Okay. So we would dance together whenever we met, and people would be mad at us because they're trying to leave. And her lover of the moment and me, you know, okay, we're dancing. Okay.
Now, I think that the reason I want to talk about their relationship is because I think that your relationship is so central to this case, because it is a marriage and a relationship that I think everyone, heterosexual or not, can relate to, that they grow up dreaming that they would have a relationship like you had with Thea. Right. Did you guys ever fight? I just need to ask that because my partner's here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, she once threw a book through a door. I mean, I was out the door, and it was one of those hollow doors, and the book went through. And what I did with that is we both went to bed separately, and I found red paper, and I made a big heart to cover the hole.
Oh.
I figured that when she woke up in the morning, she shouldn't remember, okay, being angry or anything like that. Okay, but that was probably she actually hit me once. She actually hit me once.
Wow. Look at Roberta, like.
Okay. Jungle. Okay. I gotta tell you. Okay. We were in the jungle, and we were in a place with rabid bats, and had only mosquito netting over us. And she was a wreck. She was terrified out of her mind, and I kept falling asleep. And that was just, you know, that
with
was
bats flying around.
Yeah. What are you gonna do? Okay. We had the mosquito netting.
All right.
And I kept saying, it's all right. Okay. You know, nothing is touching us. And we could fall asleep again, and that was driving her crazy even more. So she socked me, and what I thought was, and we weren't really together yet. We were dating, but that's all. But I had my thought was that, you know, I'll get home to civilization, and I'll never talk to this woman again. Okay. I mean, it was awful. And anyhow, then we got caught in the rapids. And she really did save my life. I can't swim worth a damn. And we had to get out of the boat in the middle of this chaos. Ugh. And then when the boat was finally going peacefully down the river, I said, well, you saved my life. That makes you responsible for it. And that was really the beginning.
And she asked you to marry her in 1967.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, I don't know about you. Like, when I was a kid, I never even thought it was possible, or I can't imagine that
it was more symbolical than anything else. We never expected to be able to
right.
be married. Okay.
And you got married in Toronto, and you as well got married
That's
in Toronto.
True.
Because in 2006, I hate to bring up the negative.
This is my fault. No, I take
it is not your
it
fault.
It is not my fault.
It is so not your fault. You were the co-counsel for the New York State.
Correct. So in 2006, in 2004, actually, we brought a case seeking the right to marry in New York under the New York Constitution, and we lost. 5 years later, we got it passed through the legislature, but we lost that case. And so the reason that Edie had to go to Toronto and the reason I had to go to Toronto is because I lost the case. But that's okay, I won a case after that.
I heard! I mean, if you think about it, it was so soon after that. I mean, did you think when that case was lost that it would be so soon that you would actually?
No, I mean, if you had told me in 2006, I think, You know, after we lost the case, I probably spent about an afternoon in bed mourning the loss. Mm-hmm. And if you had told me at that point, either that the New York legislature only 5 years later would pass a statute, or that we would win federal rights through Edie's case, I would have told you you were on drugs.
Right.
No question about it.
And I probably was on drugs.
You probably were.
All right, I have a question that, I asked an attorney friend of mine as well, this question. Now, Edie comes to you, will you take this case? Had you asked other people prior?
Asked the gay organizations, okay? I took the film, and I said I have a documented marriage. You know, somebody help me, I really want to do this. And I was indignant as hell.
Right.
I mean, it wasn't just the money. Okay, but the money with my suit was about the money.
Right.
The idea of that is, okay, you can't sue the federal government on principle. You have to have been hurt. And so my hurt was that they took all that money from me. But my real hurt was that they treated my lover of 42 years at that point, okay, as if she was a stranger.
Right. Okay. And so when you heard the case, did you?
There was no case.
No, but when you heard Edie's story, let's say.
There's a man in the audience, okay, Brendan Fay, okay, who had introduced me to the judge who married us, but who also was who he called a friend of his and said, you know, they're not taking Edie's case and it's wrong. And that friend is who called Robbie.
Okay. Right.
And that's how we met. Okay.
Wow. And you just said yes. I mean.
First of all, I didn't know Edie, mm-hmm. But I knew who Thea was, because if you were a lesbian in New York City for the past 35 years,
right.
And someone said, I'm looking for a lesbian psychologist, they said, go see Thea Spire. So
right.
I knew who Thea was. I have a lot of friends who knew Thea and who saw Thea's patients. I knew immediately, you know, who we were talking about. And I knew that they lived nearby, so I live 4 blocks away from Edie. So I walked over her house the very next day, and I heard the story, and it literally took me 2.5 seconds to decide it was the perfect case for such obvious reasons. I mean, it's not me. It's not like I'm a genius. It's pretty obvious.
I think you're a genius.
The marriage, you know, the 40-year relationship. Someone who uses words like indignant.
Right.
Nice to have a client who uses words like indignant. The incredible damage. I know Edie, and it was about the dignity. There's no question it was about the dignity, but $363,000 is not pocket change for anyone. And the nature of their relationship. It's not only the joy that they had, but Thea's illness and the fact that they battled that illness together, and that anyone would want to have that kind of a relationship when they're faced with something like a diagnosis of MS. So it just seemed to me in so many ways. Justice Ginsburg recently called their relationship a grand partnership. And that's exactly what it was. And fortunately, we were able to persuade the court that that's exactly what it was.
And if anything's going to strike a nerve with conservatives, it's taxes and paying your taxes. And I mean, it's really the perfect case.
Exactly. Any American gets in their gut what it means to have to pay a tax simply because you're gay.
Right.
And that's all this was. This was a tax that was levied upon Edie because she was married to a woman and not a man.
Why do you think the Supreme Court took this case?
Well, they had to take, once DOMO was struck down, they had to take the case, because the Supreme Court generally has a policy that if federal statutes are held to be unconstitutional, they hear it. Mm-hmm. And that's why you're probably gonna have one of these cases from Utah or Virginia or another state like that go up. So they had to take a DOMA case. Why they took Edie's case, I'd like to say it was all these great facts, and mm-hmm. maybe that's true, but I think it has more to do with the fact that the Second Circuit, which is the appellate court here in New York, really rushed its decision of the case. We argued the case, and I think they issued their decision 4 weeks later. And once that decision was out, ruling our way and ruling not only that we won, but that any laws that treat gay people differently were subject to very high scrutiny under the law, which was a first-time ruling in the United States, it was pretty clear the Supreme Court was going to take our case.
You told Edie that she couldn't talk about sex.
True.
during...
I confess, I have to admit that.
Well, that New Yorker article was... Did you like the New Yorker article?
Pardon?
The article on the New Yorker?
Okay. It embarrassed me, but ultimately, just from everybody's reaction, I liked it.
Okay. It was yes.
Ariel is a terrific reporter. Mm-hmm. She's very responsible, and she's very... She's charming, and so she kind of, you know, she brings you out, and you say things spontaneously
right.
that you might not.
And then she writes okay. it down for everyone. Yes, so, yeah.
Yes, okay. And the thing is, I did fact-checking, and the first thing when I saw the first sentence,
right.
you know, I don't know if you guys, can I say the first sentence? The first sentence is, fuck the Supreme Court.
Yes.
Okay. And then she goes on to explain that that's not
Let's
what I meant.
Let's be very clear, that's what Edie said.
I never said
that. Okay. Yes, okay. And,
future justice of the Supreme Court. Okay. We can only hope.
Yes. Okay, and anyhow, as we went through, I said, look, if Ariel says I said it, I said it. I wish I hadn't. I wish she would take it out, and she won't. Okay. And I knew she wouldn't. It was a real come on. I mean, I would have continued to read the article if it
right.
started with that, no question. Okay. She did take out one thing, which was, and again, there was nothing incorrect. Everything that she said, I said. Okay. But she had my husband's name, okay, and I asked her to take it out. And she had to actually fight with her editor about it because he said, reporters don't do that. And she said, it matters a lot, okay. And I don't want her to be that unhappy with it. And they took it out, okay. I didn't know then that his wife and children knew if he had been married, that he had been married before. Mm, and
right.
I was very concerned for that. I later, much later, I was about when Diana Nyad was in town swimming. There was a party at night celebrating her swim from Cuba, and we were there, and we were going to the party first of all, and I had my coat on ready to leave the house, and the phone rang, and somebody was being hesitant, and I said, please talk fast, I'm just leaving, and she said, Saul's wife. And I said, wait a minute, let me take my coat off. Okay. And we talked for about half an hour. And she knew, she said, he talked about you all the time. He never stopped loving you. My kids know about you. She knew the names of my siblings. And I said to her, I said, I was so glad, to see that he married a beautiful woman and that he had a great life. And I saw it. And she said, how do you know all that, though? And I said, well, one of your kids put stuff on the internet. And somebody from Philadelphia called me and said, if you want it, it's all there. And so he was still interested in music and having it,
right.
okay. So we had a wonderful conversation, and as soon as I finish this next set of busyness, she's gonna come to New York, and we're gonna, okay.
Oh, that's okay. So great.
Don't
invite Ariel from the New Yorker. Thank God you didn't tell Ariel about how, she hit you, Thea hit you. What went through your mind when, I'd love for both of you, when you saw the words Edith Windsor versus the United States?
You first.
Well, this is what I do for a living.
Right.
So for me, that's what I do. Suing the government is part and parcel of bringing civil rights cases and bringing these kinds of cases. We spend a lot of time, you're gonna hear Edie's reaction. We did spend a lot of time preparing, I think, Edie and talking to her about it, what it would mean and mm-hmm. what the implications were and whether there would be criticism, et cetera. So we did, but it's, having done this for a long time, I know it's always different for a client and it's always different being a plaintiff in a case. So Edie should go ahead and say how she reacted to it.
Okay, how I reacted for the moment, I was terrified. And then there's an organization that supports the St. Patrick's Day Parade for All. The alternative St. Patrick's Day Parade. Also, its origins were with the same man, Brendan Fay. And they have a fundraiser at the Irish Community Center every year to raise money for the parade. And right after I read that, I went to one of these things, and and Brenda asked me to say if I would say a few words. And I said, okay, what's important is this. It's very frightening when you see Edith Windsor versus the United States of America. I want everybody in this room to understand it's Brendan's fault. All the way through. And if anybody from the government asks you, just explain that it's Brendan's
fault. I should also say it's a lot better to be E. Windsor suing the United States of America than the United States of America.
Right, that's true. That is true.
Which is how it reversed.
Which is how it reversed because of some legal issues at the Supreme Court.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Tell us about It's All About Edie Stupid.
Yeah, so, you know, one of the things, a lot of the cases that had been brought in the past in raising the issue of gay couples and their ability to marry, their rights to marry under the Constitution, had been brought as group cases. And what I mean by that is there were often four, five, six, seven couples, often very diverse, older men, women, different racial groups, et cetera. And that was for good reason. You want to kind of have the diversity of the community represented in the case. I think what no one really realized, though, in prior cases until we brought this case, is that if you bring a case and it's six couples rather than one couple, that what happened is the facts of those people's lives kind of washed into the background.
Right.
And the cases seemed more like a political fight, like a debate between Fox News and MSNBC than a case about a real person in their lives.
Right.
So from minute one in our case, it was very, very important for us to make this case about Edie Windsor and her life. We really strategized from the very beginning that was our goal. I think we succeeded. And when I was writing the brief before the Supreme Court, which actually had a lot of, you know, pretty complicated legal principles and cases and precedents, I had a post-it that I put up on my computer that said it's all about Edie Stupid, borrowing from the Clinton campaign, because I wanted to constantly remind myself that that's always was the touchstone of the case. And almost all the legal principles in the case, we were able to bring them back to things from Edie's life to really hit home for the court what this was really about. And again, when you have Ruth Bader Ginsburg saying it's a grand partnership, you know, she clearly got it.
What do you think the purpose of DOMA was initially? Like, what was the purpose of it? I mean, was it for Clinton to say, here, I'm just gonna, this is my bargaining chip? They used the term moral disapproval. I mean, it was a moral issue for, you know, that's the way they...
Well, it was a very, very different world in 1996. There's mm-hmm. no question about that. And DOMA was a unique statute in a lot of ways. One way in which it was incredibly unique is it was supposed to stop a problem, this problem of gay people getting married before any gay people
right,
in the country were getting married. In 1996 was before Vermont, before Massachusetts. There was no gay people were getting married anywhere, but there was such a fear of the unknown, such a fear of gay people and what they meant and what their relationships meant, that this statute was passed really kind of in fear and lack ignorance, I would say, about what gay people are like. And the world is very different today. So one of the arguments we made in the case is we're not saying that everyone who supported DOMA was a homophobe. We're not saying that they were prejudiced. Some of them might have been, some of them weren't. But what we are saying is that in 1996, people didn't understand what it was to be gay and what it was to be in a relationship as a gay person. And the fact that Edie's relationship with Thea was just like any other relationship of any straight couple who'd been together 40 years. And it's that misunderstanding
right.
that led to DOMA. So while in 1996, when Congress passed DOMA, they said they were passing it out of a moral disapproval of gay people, today what we have, thanks to the efforts of the people in this room and so many others, is a moral understanding. It's the flip. It's a moral understanding that gay people and our relationships are no different than anyone else.
What were the most important amicus briefs that were presented?
I think the three most important were the brief of military. We brought this case after Don't Ask, Don't Tell, and it was a terrible, terrible problem in the military. Actually, gay soldiers were dying mm-hmm. in the line of duty who were married, and because of DOMA, they weren't married for purposes of federal law, so the Pentagon would have to inform their parent and not their spouse that they'd been injured or hurt or killed. At the funerals, they would give, and this is a very big deal in military culture, they would have to give the flag on top of the coffin to the parent and not the spouse, because they weren't a spouse. And I know for a fact that this really agonized the Pentagon brass. I mean, it just drove them crazy. They were very upset about it. So we had a couple very, very powerful briefs that talked about that. We had an incredibly powerful brief from the business community, 278 companies.
Wow. IBM?
IBM, Citigroup, Apple, you name it. And it was so bad that at the end you have to actually print Supreme Court briefs using a formal printer in D.C., and companies were actually begging to get their names on before we had to send it to the printer. That was very, very powerful. And I think for me, it was the brief of religious organizations. In the past, in these cases, most of the religion briefs were from groups that were gay religious groups. And there's nothing wrong with that. Being gay and religious, I have no problem with gay religious groups. But it was very important in this case for us to explain that this is not an issue just for religious people on one side. That religious people, very important religious people who take their religious beliefs very seriously, were on both sides of this issue. So for the first time ever, we had a brief from very mainstream religious groups, Presbyterian groups, Methodist groups, Universalist groups, and this is my personal point of pride, for the first time ever, the entire Jewish conservative movement signed on to a brief. The Jewish Theological Seminary, for the first time in its history, signed an amicus brief in our case.
Wow.
Saying that DOMA was unconstitutional. We even had an Orthodox rabbi sign on to the.
Really?
And next time there'll be more than one.
I hope so. And of course, the most important was the Westboro Baptist Church.
Well, right.
Amicus brief.
Exactly. We got great advice from our co-counsel, Pam Carlin, that on amicus briefs, that we should not give what's called blanket permission to the other side to file amicus briefs. So what that meant is every time someone wanted to file an amicus brief against us, they had to send me an email asking permission. And you have to give permission. The court's going to grant it. But the greatest thing is you know who's going to file the brief.
Right.
So the very first email we got was from Westboro Baptist Church, and I think I emailed them back in 3 seconds, said, be my guest.
Now, you walk into the Supreme Court. There they are. My first question is, did Justice Thomas, did you hear him breathe or make any noises whatsoever? Is he alive? Anything? Any noise come out of his body whatsoever?
He was definitely there.
Okay, he was there.
He did not ask me any questions. And
what?
Because he didn't ask me any questions, I can't really tell you what he did or said.
Okay, okay.
Because I was only focused on people grilling me.
So you walk in. What do you think? Like, what is it?
Well, first of all, let me do the whole kind of shtick, because it was more than just my argument. We were there. We got there early. There were a lot of people in the audience. Edie was kind of, people were parading back and forth to Edie. Our co-counsel and I had a joke about whether who had the highest hair in the court that day, whether it was me or Nancy Pelosi. I think Nancy Pelosi won out. My hair was pretty high. And people were basically kind of congregating, and a lot of people were coming to see Edie. I tried to kind of like zone that out. I was sitting up front, and I didn't want to be even more stressed than I already was. So Edie can tell you more about it. I tried not to pay attention to it. And then when the argument happens, on the one hand, for the first 2 seconds, you're like, oh my God.
Right.
You know, I'm Robbie Kaplan from Cleveland, Ohio, and I'm about to argue to the Supreme Court. On the other hand, once you start, it's like any other court. And once they get going and they're asking you the questions, you could be in the Supreme Court, you could be in New York, it doesn't really matter. And you kind of go into the zone and you try to answer the questions as best as you can.
And Edie, were you?
First, I want to say something about her. She was so cool and calm and informed, it was a miracle. It really was a miracle. Okay, when somebody tried, one of the justices tried to bait her, okay?
Really?
And she stayed cool and just, you know, proceeded with making her points. It was amazing. And I just went, oh God, you know, we're gonna win.
I have to explain to you
what the court looks like, though. The justices are up here, and the people are down there. The first people are the lawyers who are going to debate the case.
Right.
Then there is a mass of rows of lawyers who are qualified to speak there. Then there is a massive rows of lawyers who are not particularly qualified to speak, but that's all that are allowed to sit there.
Right.
Then there is an aisle. And then there is the first guest row, which is only guests of the justices. The second guest row is us. Okay. Me on the far left, Nancy Pelosi on the far right, who got up and walked over and kissed me on both cheeks and said how wonderful it was to meet me. Oh. And I was thrilled, just, you know, okay. There was a point in the court, and she's handling it perfectly. Unbelievable. There was a point in the court when, as a result of the day before, they had more information about the number of children of gay people, and Justice, help me, Justice Kennedy said, okay, in response to something one of the other justices had said, he said, what about 40,000 children in California? And I said, oh God, we won, okay. Because his vote was the vote we needed. Okay.
Was there any point during the proceedings where you thought, you know, this is not gonna, did you know deep in your heart you were gonna win?
No, I don't think any
really?
Of us could. You couldn't know that, okay. What I knew was, I had said after the appeals court, when the press asked me, you know, how I thought it went, I said, if there's justice, we won. But I have to define justice as they read the briefs.
Okay. Right.
And I felt that very strongly. And Pam, our third lawyer, okay, who had clerked for Supreme Court justices, said, Edie, not only do they read the briefs, but their aides read the briefs and they talk about them. So that gave me much more confidence that we had a very good chance. Our briefs were fantastic. And the oppositions were insane.
Right.
led by the Westboro Baptist Church.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Who baited you?
I'm not gonna say.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Scalia.
Actually, Justice Scalia asked me only think one or two questions.
Really?
Yeah.
Who were you surprised the most by of the?
No, I wasn't really, I was much more surprised by what they didn't ask than what they did ask.
Right.
And what I mean by that is it took me 2 weeks to realize this, but none of the justices, in particular none of the conservative justices, asked me one question about the rationales for DOMA.
Right.
So there were all these reasons being given by the other side about why this statute survived the constitutional scrutiny, and no one asked a question about it. And 2 weeks later, when this hit me, I realized, we're going to win this case, because if they're not willing to ask me that question and hear my answer,
right,
and more importantly, hear the answer of Alana Kagan and Ruth Bader Ginsburg, then they're not feeling too good about this statute.
What do you think the central debate was in this argument? I think we're fighting for equal rights, but I also think that one of the major factors is respect.
Absolutely, there's no question. Justice Kennedy in his decision uses the word dignity 11 times in 23 pages, so do the math. It's almost, you know, a time a page practically, or every other page. And that really is what this case was about. We were convinced that if the court agreed with us that there was no difference between the marriage that Edie and Thea had, between the marriages of gay people and the marriages of straight people, then we would win this case. And the whole oral argument was about that.
I mean,
really, my oral argument was about, is there a difference? The world has changed, and why has it changed?
Mm-hmm.
And once the court has said now that gay people and our relationships have equal dignity, I think, you know, there's more fighting to do, but it's all over but the fighting.
Right.
Because you can't justify treating gay people differently if they have equal dignity.
Where were you when you found out?
You can go first.
In Robbie's, around Robbie's dining table is where we were. Okay, we each had a computer. We were watching the SCOTUS blog.
Right.
Now, someone again in the audience showed me a picture of her it's like an honorary son. I forget the word.
Godson?
Okay, yeah, mm-hmm. Okay. Who had run out of the court. And what the TV showed us all is this SCOTUS blog was not allowed in the court. They were not allowed to be press, okay? But they were the most informative. And somebody ran out of the court. The moment there was a decision, someone ran out of the court
right.
to give SCOTUS the information so that we would all have it. Okay. And I'm thrilled to meet this person here tonight. Okay.
Now, I know how I felt. How did you feel? Well, we were really waiting for three things, right? We knew people do all this complicated statistical analysis of who's written opinions
right.
and who still has opinions to write. And based on that analysis, they had concluded that the two opinions that day were going to be written by the Chief Justice Roberts and Kennedy. Call me crazy, but we thought that if we were going to win, our decision would probably be written by Kennedy and not Roberts. And that meant, because of Supreme Court protocol, that our case would have to be announced first.
Mm-hmm.
So we were waiting, A, to hear Windsor was first, B, that the decision was being written by Kennedy, and three, we then saw on the screen a SCOTUS blog that Scalia was dissenting. When we saw those three things,
right.
we knew we'd won. We didn't need to know anything more.
Right.
And there was just sheer pandemonium. I mean, there was screaming, there was crying.
There
was oh my God.
Crying.
Everywhere in this entire country. And what did you do to celebrate? I know, since we are at the 92nd Street Y, I must mention that Roberta Kaplan's synagogue wrote a psalm for her. Which is, I mean, come on. They wrote a psalm for you. You have a psalm.
Well, I'm very lucky. One of my dear friends who helped on the brief that I mentioned earlier is Rabbi Jan Urbach,
mm-hmm.
who's a conservative rabbi and teaches at the seminary and has been a huge help to us all throughout the case. And in Jan's inimitable and classy style, she decided the best way to commemorate this was to set some words from the Psalms to music, which is what she had done.
It's beautiful, too. You have to go online. It's amazing. I have a question. All right, the world is changing. I mean, Utah, what is going on? And they said that they want to slow down. What's happening there?
Look, what's happening is essentially what I've said, which is you can't say that gay people have equal dignity
mm-hmm.
on the one hand, and say on the other hand that they should be treated differently.
Right.
So whether it's Utah or New York or Virginia or California, it doesn't really matter. The Constitution is the Constitution, and the principles are the principles. And any judge reading Windsor and reading what the court has said leads to the inescapable conclusion that gay people have to be treated equally.
And you think about it, it's not that it's not this law that we are entitled to get married. It is a law saying we are entitled to be treated like other married couples.
Exactly.
When is it going to happen where, we should have the right to get married?
I'd be a genius. I mean, I'd,
right.
I'd be a,
and a fortune
billionaire
teller.
If
I
could
like
predict
to
that.
Quote a genius. Okay, somebody Siegel, first name Dale, who was the I forgot what you call these guys who do this kind of computing.
Statistics?
Actually, counted exactly the number of votes even by which Obama would win the second
right.
election.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Okay, he has now said what his calculations, and there was that piece that this guy from Harvard wrote, but he quoted this guy. The fact is that he lists all of the criteria that he used, and then he says by 2020, 37 states will have marriage, and by 2024, all of them.
Oh, we'll get there before that, because the Supreme Court isn't going to let it go that way.
Right. What do you think the last state's
okay, a lot
be?
Of people, but a lot of statisticians agree with him.
What's going to happen is there are going to be when we brought the case, five states only, this is amazing. We brought this case in 2010, only five states allowed gay couples to marry. New York became the sixth state in 2011 during the case. When I argued the case in March, nine states plus the District of Columbia. When we won the case, 12 states. And today it was 18, but now it's 17 because
right.
we stay in Utah. I mean, that's incredible.
Right.
No other group has made that kind of progress. And it's kind of funny to say what the last state is because there won't be a last state. That will get to a point where a bunch more states will pass
right.
marriage, either through the legislature or through court decisions. And then some case is going to get to the Supreme Court. And it's before Alabama or Mississippi or Texas pass it, that right. I can promise you. And the Supreme Court is going to have to decide this issue. And, you know, subject, unless there's some radical change in the makeup of the Supreme Court's going to decide that gay people have an equal right to marry.
You know, I am a firm believer of coming out of the closet. And a lot, it's fine, thank you. Gay, by the way. And I'm always, I have to know your thoughts, because I'm always thrilled. I'm not thrilled anymore when people come out of, like Robin Roberts came out of the closet. We all knew. Because we have a secret society and everyone. Oh my God, it's such an amazing, and I think, really? I mean, I look at you and what you've done for us, and the fact that I'm glad she came out of the closet, but that it took so long, that it took a devastating illness and a horrible year in her life. I mean, we should be thrilled, but I mean, I have these mixed feelings about how long it takes celebrities to come out, because I believe that if everyone in this country realized that they do know and love a gay person, because everyone does, then the world would be a completely different place.
More and more people are coming out. I think the use of the word dignity and had a huge effect. I think the popes, who am I to judge?
Your competition.
Had a
right.
huge
Exactly.
Okay, that's right. I think that's the most useful use of
right.
bully pulpit that anyone has ever done.
Right.
I don't mind his beating me. what has happened is, as more of us come out, it just becomes safer somehow. And it's fear and fear of, first of all, homophobia
right.
is incredibly reduced just by the decision and by the numbers of people coming out. My feeling was that I made a speech even that just for the gay community, which had to do with, it started in Stonewall when I was a middle class jackass who said, I don't know why I have to be identified with those queens. Only those queens turned my life around when they did the Stonewall stuff. Okay, and I said, oh God, I see them finally.
Right.
Okay, and they're, okay. And then came when the AIDS crisis, okay. At that point, and a lot of you were too young to have been there, at that point, there were the lesbians and there were the gay men, and the events either had one or the other. And occasionally there was a person on one side or the other of the wall who had friends on the other side. But mostly they were two different worlds. When the lesbians rushed in to help, okay, that wall came down, and suddenly we saw more of each other and loved what we saw. Okay. And I think that's what keeps, it keeps getting easier and pleasanter and offering more to come out. And I think that's what we're seeing, and I think we'll continue to see it.
Yeah, I mean, we are a community now, I do remember, that really was an awful way to come together, but. Yeah. Are you gonna watch the Olympics?
Pardon me?
Are you gonna watch the Olympics?
Yeah, we have people, really gutsy people, going to the Olympics. Okay, and I guess I have to watch just because of that. I'm not really interested in sports.
What?
I know, it's terrible. It's terrible.
Get rid of that stereotype, okay. But,
Pam Carlin here. Pam knows a lot about sports.
Pardon me?
We need Pam here, because Pam knows a lot about sports.
Yeah, okay, and I just spent 8 days with Billie Jean King, who is going to the Olympics. Okay, and I'm sure she's going to have the best protection anybody could possibly have, but it still takes a lot of guts.
Oh, yeah. And Brian Boitano.
And Brian Boitano, who decided based on the
Russian
thing, that he had to come out.
Right. So how do you feel about do you think we should go to Russia? And, it's a human rights I think it's awful that we're
I'm actually a Russian history major, believe it or not. I don't use that very much, but I was a Russian major in college, and I spent
Speak Russian?
And I spent six months living in Russia when I was a junior in college during the Soviet Union. And so I'm very well aware of the kind of, not only the history, but the way that the current Russian government just has complete contempt for people's rights, not only gay people, but a lot of other people, anyone who wants to speak up and have freedom of liberty and freedom of expression. So it's a very important issue. The question really is strategically, is it better to be there in protest the way that people like Billie Jean King are? And the president very clearly has made it clear that that's his view in terms of appointing people like
Billie. I know, which I love.
Or is it better not to be there? And, you know, I just practice law. I'm just a country lawyer. I can't.
Who speaks Russian? Who knew that?
My father.
But there will be a lot. I can tell you, as someone who spent time there, for the Russian people to see Billie Jean King and see people like that on TV, you know, proud and out there, I think will be very significant and very powerful.
I want to know, you know, you're our hero, you know, and I mean, you are.
Thank you.
Thank you. Every meaning of a hero. Who are your heroes?
My heroes. Wow. Oh, that's very hard. That's very hard. Thea Spire was my hero, definitely. I don't have heroes, I don't think. I think there's something, I don't want to use the word democratic, but okay, but there's something that I don't see heroes. I see people, okay, and I see very, and I see lovable people, okay. I think that's about it.
Do you see, I mean, can you comprehend how, when we see you, that, I mean, that you are a part of history, that you are the Rosa Parks, the,
I love it, okay. I love it when people put on their Christmas card, you know, the five things, most important things that happened in our lives this year, and I'm second and third.
Right.
Okay, okay. I love it, okay. But I don't feel like a hero.
How do you want to be remembered?
Again, I don't know. Okay.
I mean, you will be never ever be forgotten.
I know that, and I like all the things that people say about me that are down in history. And I wish they wouldn't just have the first sentence of Ariel's on. But that's life.
Now, Roberta, you can't top. How are you going to top this one? I think you should be our next Supreme Court Justice. I do. I really do.
Well, thank you. I mean, there are a lot of Republican senators that would have a say on that. So.
Too bad. Oh my God, you're amazing. You're amazing, and you're so young, and you speak Russian, which is incredible.
Very helpful for Supreme Court arguments.
We wanted to open up questions to the audience, if that's okay. I'm sure everyone has.
Oh, there's an audience? Oh,
yeah. Yes. Yes.
Right, one of them has to
that we didn't need the Supreme Court.
That there was such popular support that the case was not, it wasn't necessary for the Supreme Court to hear this because the country itself was evolving in favor.
She asked if, the country was already in favor of you and this case. Did we really need the Supreme Court, which,
Yes, we did. Yes, we did, right? Do you agree?
That there was a feeling, yes.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think that there's a relationship between the two. I mean, I think that both in our country, democracy and popular opinion and the Constitution have a kind of a living dialogue with each other. And I think that was very much at play in this case. And you could see the way popular opinion impacted the court and legal opinions, and then the legal opinions in turn impacted public opinion. So it was very much a dynamic process. As a practical matter, I know Edie said it wasn't that important, but she wanted her money back.
Right.
And the only way we were going to get her a check back is for the Supreme Court to rule. So, and to make clear that no one else would ever have to suffer the indignity that she had to suffer ever again. So we needed a formal ruling to get that.
How long did it take to get the check back? I'm just curious.
Well, the state was very fast.
Really?
The state was, New York State, not only was it very fast, but Governor Cuomo actually, in his press release, pointed out that there was 3 years, you know, that, I forgot what it's called again, but and that if this had happened to anyone in the last 3 years, that they had lost a mate and paid tax, okay, that
they had a
eligible for refund.
Wow.
And in his opening speech,
wow.
Okay, and told them what, you know, and said, here's the phone numbers, here's the address, okay.
And then the federal government took forever?
The federal government took longer. We knew though, right? They really let you know, I think, that they were working on it. It was just a question of
the
process.
Right. Did you...
The IRS.
I hope you took a little picture of that.
Pardon me?
Did you take a picture of the check?
No, I didn't, but I think she did.
I have a picture.
Oh, right. I bet you do.
A color picture of the check.
Yes. Luann.
Would you, one of you, repeat the
question? She's from New Jersey, and because of this case, they now have marriage equality in New Jersey.
As a direct result of your case.
As a direct result.
But as part of the movement, there's also been the political, the elections, the votes in legislatures. How do you view that in terms of, has it helped legal cases in terms of the movement going forward, and do you think that will continue?
My view, just like I said, in terms of popular opinion in the courts, I think the same thing is true with politics in the courts. I mean, it's really, what's the genius of our system and of our constitutional system is this dynamic relationship between the legislatures and the courts. And New York is the perfect example in a way. I mean, we lost the case in New York in 2006. At that point, we thought it was over. I mean, we were all thought there was nothing was gonna happen. It was the dark days, we would never get these rights. 5 years later, the New York legislature, by an overwhelming majority, passed marriage equality in New York. And then, just a few years after that, we won the DOMA case, making sure that people who were married in New York not only had state rights, but had federal rights as well. So this kind of relationship where you have some political progress, and then you have progress in the courts, and then you have more political progress, I think that's only bound to continue because that's the way our system was structured.
How can this best be used as a model? You use the word dignity, which I think is absolutely essential that people understand that and not think it's about marriage. How can that best be used around the world as a model for the struggle for civil rights? You talked, I think, about polygamy on NPR today, for instance. That's just one example of how to do marriage. But in all cultures, in all around the world, what you have focused on, the dignity of relationships, is a central concept for creating civil rights.
I'd have to say, I'm partially deaf, so I always have to have the question repeated for me. Would one of you do
so
that?
How has dignity, to what extent does this concept of dignity contribute to the civil rights struggle, not only for gay people, but for other groups?
Wow, that's hard. Go ahead.
I mean, I think, you know, people touched earlier on one of the reasons why there's been such incredibly dramatic success in terms of gay civil rights. And that's because, as Edie put it, you know, one day someone decided to come out of the closet, and then another person, and then another person. And it's at the point today where every single one of the justices of the Supreme Court, even Justice Scalia, admits he probably has friends who are gay.
It's there. They have to be out of their minds.
It takes that kind of understanding. I mean, what happened with Rob Portman in Ohio is again a perfect example. He woke up one morning and he realized he had a son who was gay, and it changed his view about all of this. I think that that same kind of looking at the other kind of person and seeing the dignity in every human being has to go across to other civil rights struggles. And the justices of the Supreme Court have to see that there's not only dignity in gay people, but there's dignity in undocumented people, there's dignity in African Americans seeking to vote, there's dignity in women wanting to have control over their own bodies. That same concept has to be carried forward into other groups.
How about the Cheneys? Any dignity there? I mean, that is just...
Well, she dropped out.
I know, she dropped out.
Dropped out of the race.
Yeah, Liz Cheney, she dropped out. Yeah, being a sore loser. Yeah. She was really sore. Yes. Shep.
Well, not originally, not at all. I mean, the cases were proceeding on separate tracks. We didn't really have hardly any communication at all with the other case until the Supreme Court took cert in both cases on the same day. And at that point, we started to cooperate, and we cooperated in terms of the amicus briefs that Judy mentioned. And I did a moot court with the Perry team together. I have to admit, this is an example where you can be like so compulsive and think you can control everything and you turn out to be wrong. When the court granted cert at the same time in both cases, I wasn't too happy about it. I thought that them granting in Perry would be a bad thing for the Windsor case because I thought that the court would associate the two cases together. I didn't think they were ready to rule on the merits in Perry, and I didn't want them to see it as one big ball of wax. As it turned out, I think the fact that the court took the two cases at the same time was a very good thing for the Windsor case, because I think it gave the court kind of an easy next step to hold DOMA unconstitutional and to save the bigger decision, the Perry decision, the ultimate right to marry for the future.
But isn't every case boring to you since you've done this? I mean...
My wife is here, Rachel Levine, and she says that I have this amazing ability to convince myself that no matter who my client is, they've never done anything wrong, correct about everything, and that I don't know whether it's a mental illness or not, but she's right about that. So I find every case pretty interesting.
Robin.
In the end, 43 and three quarters years.
What is the secret?
What's the secret?
What is the secret?
Okay.
You can say it now.
I know.
Yeah,
I have it.
Go for it.
Okay. The real secret, I think, is to really love. And I've only recently come to be able to articulate what I mean by love. I mean by love that you care as much for the other person's quality of life as you care for your own. And if you both do that, longevity is kind of easy.
Oh God, I'm gonna be hearing that all night.
Well,
oh boy.
I'm going to give my opinion about this. My view is that who we are, who someone is as a gay person, fundamentally, is who they love, right? That's what it is to be gay. It's you love someone of the same sex. That kind of defines the whole thing. And in our society, And in our legal system, whether you want to marry or not, and I have no issue with people, who, I believe me, who don't want to get married. Marriage is hard. But who you love in our society and in our legal system is defined by marriage. And if we have, as gay people, have equality in marriage, have the equal ability to get married to straight people, then we are equal under the law. And there will be no other issues with respect to discrimination against gay people in our society. That's why the marriage battle is so important. That's why it's so significant. That's why it's so symbolic, because it talks about who we fundamentally are as gay people and whether that quality is equal to other people under the Constitution.
You know, the basic tenet that there is separation of church and state, okay? And then you hear Scalia, I don't understand how they get away with that. It's mind-boggling to me. That is the issue that is constantly brought up.
Right. Well, it's a great example of our progress, because when these arguments, I first started arguing these cases in 1994, and then, you know, what you would hear is it's terrible for children, it's right. terrible for society, society's gonna fall apart, there'll be chaos in the streets, there'll be rioting, all that's gonna happen if gay people can get married. Now no one's making those arguments. You didn't even see them in the briefs in our case. The only arguments that are being made today is if we allow, you know, if we recognize Edie and Thea's marriage, then somehow that violates my religion, because I can't stand in my religion to see you as married. And as you put it, Judy, given the fact that there's separation of church and state, it makes no sense.
Right.
But that's the argument they're left with, and that's just proof of how strong our arguments are and how far this issue has progressed.
When do you think religion is gonna, I mean, I feel like our country is getting more religious. It is, we are, there are so many religious zealots in this country, and I'm done with these political speeches with the God bless America at the end of the, it infuriates me on a certain level.
I mean, I think the best way to combat that is to make it clear, as we try to do in this case, that it's not just a religious issue on one side. That religion, at least my religion, talks about the dignity, not just Justice Kennedy's dignity, the dignity of human beings. That I'm taught as a Jew to believe that every human being has dignity. And that same dignity that governs Jewish law, that governs the Torah, should govern the sense that we as Americans, how we treat each other and how our Constitution treats each other. And it's not that there isn't separation, there is separation, but that moral understanding, that spark of understanding comes from morality. And it's not just from religious people on one side. Religious people on our side believe that gay people have dignity as well.
Right. Yes.
Okay. And not when you came out, when you knew you were gay.
That's a very difficult question, because I can remember a moment when I was something like 7, when I roller skated with a girl to look at what was going to be my new house where my parents were moving. And I remember we sat on the curb, we're tired, and I found a telephone booth and telephoned home to say, would somebody please come get us, okay? And I was sitting there on the curb with my arm around her, and if I look back, I say, maybe that was a clue. Okay. But I dated boys all through high school and through the beginning of college, okay? I married my husband in absolutely good faith, but I had already had my first serious love affair with a woman. And I had originally broken my engagement with him, in fact. Okay. And he would call me up on New Year's and say, what are we doing for New Year's Eve? And we would go back to dating again. So I didn't want to be gay, okay? It was no way to be in those days. I thought it was impossible. I remember rejecting this great love, okay, and saying, you know, there's no way we could live, okay? No, and ultimately walking away from it. So I didn't really know. Certainly I knew before Thea, but not a hell of a lot before. Okay. So it's very hard. It was hard to know just because I grew up in a different world from you guys. I grew up surrounded by Freudians. Okay.
And married a psychologist.
And women could only, women, you're not really a woman if you can't come vaginally. I mean, try that. That we believe that. I'm allowed now, right? I'm allowed now. Okay. But that, but that was what the world that it was. So it was really, you really were inferior, or at least your life was going to be inferior if you chose that way. And if you could possibly not choose that way, you did it. Okay. And ultimately, I couldn't do it because I was jealous if I saw two women together on a Saturday night. And I had never been out with a woman on a Saturday night until I was 30 years old.
Wow. Okay.
I had only been out with boys. And then.
Roberta?
You have to go next.
Mine's so boring. When I was three, I always knew I was gay, and I didn't know what it was until I went through puberty, and I was like, oh, that's what that is. I always felt different. My son's here, I'm sure he's gonna appreciate this. I always felt different. I always wanted to do boy things. I had different feelings with my girlfriends, at school. I'd get like really hurt over something. It was ridiculous, And I'd be like, I'd have one obsession with the one person across the street. I'm like, I have to see them all the time, you know. And, I am a living, breathing example that you were born this way, because I'm a six on that Kinsey scale, I'm telling you right now. I did attempt, oh God, my son's here. But anyway, I did try. I think the hardest thing, I was born in 1962. So when I went to college, I felt like I had to try it. Straight people don't feel like they have to try being gay to prove that they're, straight. And I, at that time, I felt like, I have to have a boyfriend. And I can't even tell you, it was so unnatural. It was literally completely unnatural to me. So I'm not giving the history of when I started being active because my son is here. 15. All right, so, yes.
For the younger people, I think this really is a sign of the progress that we've made. I mean, I'm around Judy's age, and God, I told my wife that when I went to graduate from Harvard in 1988, and I told her there were no lesbians at Harvard. She's like, what? That's impossible. But that was the world that I lived in, and it took me a long time. My third year in law school.
Wow.
That was when I first was able to deal with it. I can't separate the two because I'm way too rational of a person to separate those two things. I'm sorry.
She wrote a brief about it. She read it.
I'll send you the brief.
She argued with herself and then, yeah. Yes.
Going into that anti-gay rights movement and this underlying, anger, religious zealot movement takes over. So I'd love to hear ideas and thoughts and what you're seeing.
I mean, can we go back? I mean, can we take any steps back?
No. I think, you know, people are, you know, even in states like Utah, there's thousands now of married couples. We don't know what the Utah government will do, but they're married.
Yeah.
And they're walking around the streets of Salt Lake City with their married spouses and their children. And, you know, I don't see any rioting on the streets of Salt Lake City.
Which is shocking, I have to say.
So the truth is that the other side does have more money, and we need to keep funding the groups on our side that are doing all this stuff, but they are wasting all their money because they're not making any progress in terms of all the money they're spending.
Right.
And that's because this country has come to this new understanding that that gay people have dignity. And, you know, I don't want to jinx it. I'm a Jewish mom, so I'm very superstitious. So I don't want to jinx things, but I don't think we're going back.
Yes?
There could be, but again, it's a little hard to see because, the Voting Rights Act is about a different situation, and I totally disagree with the decision, but it's about whether people, you know, whether there's a sense that people are really having trouble voting through the country. With respect to gay people, there's no issue, obviously, about gay people voting. There's an acknowledgement by the courts that gay people are entitled to constitutional protections, and that we're the same with respect to other people with respect to constitutional protections. Even if the composition of the court changes, I can't see the court going back on that because I don't know what they'd say. What decision are they going to write? We changed our minds? Gay people don't have dignity anymore? That's a very difficult decision, mm-hmm. even for a conservative majority on the court to write. So I think, you know, that while there's a lot of work to do and there's a lot of political progress that needs to be made and there's some more cases that need to be fought, I think that we're on a one-way path with respect to the rights of gay people. That doesn't mean that we don't keep fighting for the rights of everyone else. And certainly on Voting Rights Act, our co-counsel is starting on Monday to be the Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights to fix the voting rights law. She's the leading expert in the United States on voting rights. So.
That's great.
If anyone can do it, Pam Carlin can. So kudos to her.
And hopefully, you know, we'll be having a female president.
Exactly.
Yeah, that would be amazing. Yes.
I just want to get your feedback on, I had the pleasure in 2008, I worked for the Human Rights Campaign, I traveled around the country, and in 2008, we would go into different states and we would tell people, you know, we're in trouble in California, we're in trouble in California, and to the point of religious zealots and to the point of the money being challenges that I have seen, certainly in the work that I've done, is participation. And I think we have tremendous participation. I mean, obviously, we filled this room tonight, and I think there's plenty of people that are on our side. But I think that one of the things that we have to overcome is sort of, with all of this momentum, many times we sort of feel like, oh, we're going to win. And yes, I believe we will, but I think only with all of our participation. So I would be curious what your thoughts are with the work that you've done and sort of where we are, what the biggest hurdle is to continue the participation and to grow the participation so that we can move out the religious zealots and so that we can keep the momentum moving on our side.
Well, among other things, I think we need to worry more as a community about the disadvantage in our community. I'm on the board of GMHC, and there are a lot of people. And it's not just a gay issue, it's a poverty issue. But there are a lot of people in our society, in our city, who are living lives that few of us can scarcely imagine, and who need the services. Children who are kicked out of their homes when they tell their parents they're gay. Other parts of the country where they don't have the kind of rights that we have in New York, in the South, in the Bible Belt, et cetera. I think we need to start focusing our efforts as a community on places like that and on people like that because they really need the help and they are really, it's really, you know, I think Windsor was great. We're going to keep winning these battles, but but we need to start turning our attention to people who don't have all the advantages that we have here in New York City and who really don't have rights. And that's where I think our focus is.
I don't understand. How did these people get elected that vote against the Violence Against Women Act? Like, how did they stay in office? And what is the reasoning behind that? Like, how is Ted Cruz? I don't get it.
Fear. They played a fear.
Yes.
Good question.
My second question.
I was going to ask that question.
Good question.
Much more serious question is, who would you each of you like to play you in the movie?
On the first question, I mean, we actually did. We had
both
that I can think of off the top of my head, at least two briefs, amicus briefs, filed by libertarian groups. Who would not, you don't ordinarily see as traditional supporters of gay rights, who filed briefs saying that DOMO was unconstitutional because of the tax issue. We also had a brief, this is, you know, cases can make strange allies. We actually had a brief from the same group that challenged the Obamacare statute on federalism grounds, saying that DOMO was unconstitutional for the same reason. So, you know, I'm a lawyer, I take whatever allies I can get, and those are three good examples of people who took our side because of these issues.
Okay, there's the magic of that, of the Obamacare thing, though. Okay, they did surveys of people asking how they felt about the new health laws, and they loved them, and how did they feel about Obamacare, and they hated it.
Okay. Right, because they said Affordable Care Act, thing, yeah.
And then it's, okay, it's a name that's been...
Yeah.
There's a certain amount of ignorance. It's, you know, it has to be overcome, ultimately. So.
I think your question should be our last. Who is going to play you in the movie?
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, come on!
I have friends who have candidates, right?
Helen Mirren, Jessica Lange, Meryl Streep.
I don't know the names of the actors altogether. So,
Roberta, who's going to play you?
You know,
come on.
We were just joking about this in my house the other day. I don't know, other than it probably needs to be someone Jewish. But other than that...
Okay, I can shop right here. Do you think it'll be a TV movie, HBO? What do you think? Yeah.
Remains to be seen.
Uh-huh. Well, I can't say thank you enough. And it has been such an honor and a humbling experience to share a stage with the two of you. You guys are just incredible. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you.